Hi, I'm Jeff Coble, and today I'm going to be talking about primer design considerations for the IMAP protocol. The primer design tool we recommend is called Primal Scheme. Primal Scheme generates two pools of primers, which generate amplicons that overlap in their coordinates that tile the genome. For further detail on the Primal Scheme tool, please watch the following tutorial.
Thanks, Jeff. Hi, I'm Chris Kent. I'm a PhD student at the University of Birmingham, working alongside Dr. Josh Quick and the Arctet Network. I'm currently the lead developer on Primal Scheme, and I'm here to talk to you about primer design best practices and how to optimize your IMAP experiments. A quick legal slide, these opinions are purely my own and I do not represent Illumina. So a fundamental technology that we use is amplicon sequencing. Amplicon sequencing is a very mature and well understood technique now, and it's used to enrich for and amplify a targeted organism's genome using PCR amplicons that tile across the genome, separated into different pools to prevent overlap. You can see from this schematic, we have the primer sites represented in orange and the amplicons represented in blue. You can see that once the PCR amplification has done, you can combine these and recover the full target's genome. This is particularly useful if you have samples with very low target concentration or very complex levels of background. The current tooling for this is Primal Scheme, or Primal Scheme 1 as we've now called it. This is a very mature tool. It was released in 2016 and it's been used very heavily since. Even if you've never used or seen this website before, you're likely to review some of its outputs if you've done SARS-CoV-2 sequencing. The Arctic style schemes, which powered Illumina COVID-seq, were used alongside the Midnight schemes. It's simple and intuitive to use. You upload a FASTA file containing the genomes you want to generate your primer scheme for, and it will return a primer.bed file containing the primers that you need to use. However, Primal Scheme 1 has a few limitations. It struggles with diversity in the input genomes. It fundamentally will try and avoid putting primers in sites with diversity, however it will allow a single mutation. This is because mutations in primer sites reduce the PCR efficiency. This means for genomes with greater than 5% diversity, Primal Scheme 1 will really struggle. It will either produce no primers at all and the scheme will fail, or it will produce primers with mutations which will produce reduced sensitivity. Primal Scheme 3 has a different approach to handling diversity. In this example, we have a position with a G and an A allele. Rather than just using a single primer to cover it, it will decide what primer is needed to cover each genome in the input file. You can see on the right, these are the primers it's decided to use. We have two variants here, one with the G allele and one with the A allele. Because different bases have different thermodynamic properties, to ensure consistent thermodynamic values, the primers had to be extended in length to account for the lesser binding of the A base. There's other Primal Scheme 3 improvements that have gone on as well. We have the improved digestion algorithm to enable multiple primers which can handle up to 25% known sequence diversity. We have an improved primer-primer interaction checker, allowing high levels of multiplexing. We also have multi-target schemes, so you can upload multiple files and have a single scheme which will cover all of them. We also have a mispriming checker. This prevents primers from binding to off-target things and producing unwanted PCR product. I'd also like to talk to you about Primal Scheme Labs. This is an open source repository for validated primer schemes. We designed this to improve traceability and remove duplication of work done on generating schemes. So if you have a project which needs to sequence measles or COVID, rather than designing your own scheme, you can search on Primal Scheme Labs to find a curated and already tested scheme. This is community driven, so if you have a scheme that works, please upload it and share it so other people can use it and accredit you for it. For the next part of this tour, we'll be using Primal Scheme 3. We'll be creating a two-pathogen scheme for RSV and COVID-19. The first step of creating a scheme is to download high-quality representative genomes. This is because Primal Scheme 3 can only handle known diversity in the input files, so you want to make sure that the input files you're using well represent the population you want to sequence. In this example, we're using the dominant strains of SARS-CoV-2. At the moment, that's JM.1. And we want to align these files to create a multiple sequence alignment. The first genome in this alignment is used as the indexing system for the primers. So often we recommend using a reference genome as the first file. Also in this scheme, we want to include RSV. This is both A and B subtypes. So we have included 10 genomes with 5 from RSVA and 5 from RSVB. And this reduces maybe about a 20% distance between all the genomes. So this is labs.primalscheme. This is our open source central repository for schemes which have previously been used or tested. We have a nice collection of schemes listed here, and you can search for particular things if you have interest in. If you have COVID schemes, if you have measles schemes, you can find the schemes that are relevant to you. So each scheme has been given a tag, whether it's tested, draft, or validated. Validated schemes have been published and have very high levels of validation. Tested schemes have been shown to work on samples, and draft schemes have been tested in silico but haven't been extensively tested yet. Of our schemes of interest, we have a curated HPV scheme, which exploits the HPV circular genome to provide 100% coverage using this amplicon that spans back to the beginning. So when you click on a scheme, it will show you this plot. On the top, it shows you how the amplicons tile across the entire genome. This second plot shows you the GC content in blue and the base occupancy in red. The base occupancy just shows you where there are gaps in the genomes, shown by a zero score. You can see there's gaps where these red lines are. We also have the entropy of the MSA to show you where hypervariable positions are and how the primer scheme handles them. We also have a list of all the primers which have passed the ThermoChecker, so you can see how well the scheme has worked and how well it's performing. We also offer a collection of tags for schemes with common search criteria, such as in Arctic schemes, schemes made by the Quick Lab. We also have collections for common use cases, such as for clinical isolates or for wastewater. Once you click on a scheme, it will show you a quick overview of how the scheme looks and how it tiles across the genome. It will then provide a bit of metadata, and it will provide you links to the key files, the primer.bed file and the reference file. So when you click on a download link, it will redirect you to the text file of the bed file hosted on GitHub. You can also access this file by clicking on the GitHub page, and you can see the files listed here alongside the overview and metadata, and provides the raw version controlled files used in the scheme. So when you upload your files to Primal Scheme 3, it can be good just to have a quick QC of the files you're uploading to make sure they are aligned and they make sense. Here is the COVID file we talked about earlier. We can see in the first position we have the COVID reference genome, followed by a bunch of genomes taken from NCBI. We can see that they align well, with only a few variants noted. Something to look out for is if you have large insertions or changes in gene synteny. That's one of the issues of Primal Scheme 3. Large gaps or large stretches of N can interfere with the algorithm. It can handle them fairly well, but it does decrease the quality of the scheme. Primal Scheme 3 can handle insertion and deletions very effectively, as long as the insertion and deletions are less than around 50 bases. More than 50 bases, and it will start to interfere with how it picks primers. And also, it will produce a large variance in amplicon size. So indels less than 50 bases are handled and not an issue. Primal Scheme 3 will reconstruct the ends of the MSA to the longest genome, so having truncated sequences is not an issue. When you start the website, this is the page to be greeted with, and you need to enter a nice scheme name. You want to pick your amplicon size depending on the sequencing technology that you are using and the sensitivity that you want. Typically 400 base pair schemes are very good for wastewater where you have very complex samples, but larger schemes such as 1000 are better for handling high levels of diversity, especially if you have quite strong samples like clinical isolates. You want to include an email listed here. This is just when the job runs, we can send you an email and to update you when it's all done. For the fine-tuning options, we have these two options called minimum base frequency. This is the frequency that an allele needs to be at to be included in primer design. Because the input files we're using only have 10 genomes, using this default minimum base frequency is fine as it will include all the variants that we have. Minimum overlap is also a default option. Normally we use 10% of amplicon length as this works very well, but if you want to customize it, you can. Furthermore, we have options to enable backtracking. This is when you create the tiling scheme. If you hit a region where you cannot create a new tiling overlap, it will take one step back up the tree and then continue and try and find another solution. It generally is very expensive to do and it will increase your run times by quite a bit. So generally it's not worth doing unless you're having issues with gaps in your scheme. Same for high GC mode. If you know the genome you want to sequence is very high GC, it's worth enabling, but otherwise it is not. When you hit the Create Scheme button, you'll be redirected to an upload page. So next you upload the files which you've pre-made. Here we have the RSV and the COVID file. You can see once they're staged to upload, you can add or remove files as you want. And when you hit Upload Files, they're uploaded and the job is started. So each step in the genome here, it will calculate what position can be used as a forward primer. It will then calculate what positions can be used as a reverse primer, and it will combine all of these to work out what amplicons meet the criteria that we need. I'm looking forward to seeing how people use this tooling to create new primer schemes to sequence new and uncharacterized viruses. As we continue to develop Primal Scheme 3, we'll be adding more modes to the website, such as a panel mode, which can target specific regions of the genome. On the next step of Primal Scheme 3, it's moved on to the next file, and you can see how it's updating the progress as it goes. So now the job is completed, we have access to a results page. This page is shareable, and you can copy the URL and distribute it. Shown below is the scheme plots. So here is how the scheme performed across the two files that we had. The first file is for the COVID genome, and you can see how the amplicons tile effectively across the entire genome. Scrolling down, we have the other plots for the RSV genome, and we can see how the amplicons also tile effectively across the entire thing. This shows that from this scheme, we have no gaps, and we should be able to recover both genomes fully from the sample. For the key files, we have the primer.bed file, which contains the primer sequences and their locations in the reference genomes. We also have the reference genome file used for analysis. We also provide access to some additional files, which most users will not need. However, they can be useful for troubleshooting. We have the config.json, which contains detailed parameters. We have a log file, which contains the information. And we also have the amplicon file and also the amplicon file with the primer locations trimmed. These can be useful for downstream analysis or troubleshooting. Once you're happy with your scheme and you've tested it, you can hit the Publish to Labs button and you can fill out these details, such as the scheme name, the amplicon size, and the scheme version. You can add and remove authors as needed, and you can set a status. Once this is all done, you can add an optional description, and you can add collection tags such as a community scheme, a whole genome, and multi-target. You can provide a contact information for us to have any queries, and you can submit to labs to be curated and added if it passes. So in this talk, we've covered how Primal Scheme 3 has improvements over Primal Scheme 1, Primal Scheme Labs and how to use it effectively, alongside how to use the web interface of Primal Scheme 3. Thank you for listening, and back to you, Jeff.
Now that we understand how our primer design tool works, we can order primers, dilute them to working concentration, and begin the library prep portion of the IMAP protocol.